not do any optimization. And what we do now, we look over the second part, which is like only optimization regardless of where the function comes from, and then I put the back together before we all go get some tapas. Alright, so this is the setup for now. I have a convex function g. So again, I just need convexity to get like convergence rates, so how far I get to the optimum. But the algorithms do not need convexity to be defined. So we need to consider basic algorithms, radial descent and acceleration, a bit of Newton, and then I go over the non-smooth ones. And I will not talk about the elliptic one, because it is almost never used in practice. So I'm going to consider like properties of G. So you should like expect that if I'm assuming more, I should converge faster, and this will happen. And keep in mind that when you do machine learning, then at the end, you don't really need to be to have very high decisions. Okay, so as I mentioned already before, if you take a empirical average, it does deviate from its expectation with a deviation of 1 over root n. So having this precision below 1 over root n is typically worthless. So before 1 over root n gets to machine precision, even Google is not there, okay? So if you use double precision, 10 minus 16, you're still very far from 1 over root n. So at the end, we're still very far from machine precision, so keep this in mind, because what may be a bad optimization method can be a good learning method. As references, very nice book by Nesterov, and nice also like monograph by Sebastian Lübeck if you want to know more about the techniques I'm going to present today and the results I'm going to present. Alright, so we have to characterize what I mean by going fast or not. So I'm trying to minimize the function g, and there are typically two ways to characterize convergence. Is if I take the simplest one first, if I take any of the minimizer, which I assume are existing, then it's the distance of to any of those minimizers. Okay, so I want to get to what we call theta star, the an admin of G, so distance from theta star is often what people use, but often you get sharper results by values of G, okay, at a given theta. What I care is to get a theta with a small value of g, and I don't care if I'm very far from theta star. So, for example, take a function like that. Okay, once I'm there, okay, in terms of function value, I'm very close to that function value, okay, but I'm very far between c theta star, okay, I'm very far then. Okay, so depending on the point of view, sometimes you want to characterize convergent by the distance to the minimizer, or just the performance compared to the one of the minimizer. Okay, so this is two types of convergence results. In a 1.5 class, I will not like go over all details, but those have some relationships. Okay, and for those who know a bit about statistics, this is very related to the difference between prediction, okay, where you care about like good predictions, this corresponds to function value of the objective function versus estimation, but I want to get close to the best predictor. Okay, so this is the same type of problems. But I will use any of the two, okay, because I don't want to get too much into the details. Alright, so let's look at value descent. So here is again my simple plot from before. So I have a convex, nice, smooth function. So again, L with the largest eigenvalues of all Hessians, and mu will be the smallest eigenvalues of all Hessians, and value descent is simply like going down the negative gradient. And here, okay, for simplicity, I'm assuming a constant step size, but that step size, okay, for smooth optimization is more or less a solved problem. You can use constant, you can use line search, you can use many different tricks, which I don't want to talk about. And for this talk, I'm going to assume a constant step size that will be like depending on the smoothness constant. This is a way to get like simple bounds. So again, my two plots, like my low condition number and large condition number. Low condition number, it goes quickly to the optimum. and otherwise close the ceilings, okay, the OT. Because this is like a behavior that you see in practice. And the question is, can we quantify this, and can we quantify really the effect of the condition number? And in fact, we can. And one thing that's important is that when you optimize a function like this, regardless of your power as an optimizer, it's hard. Okay? So if it's slow, it's not our fault. It may be the fault of the problem. Okay? So keep in mind that some problems are hard, and some problems are easy. Okay? So if you give us, okay, I'm putting myself in the spot of the optimizer, if you give me a hard problem, I need to give you a slow algorithm. Okay? It's not my fault. Okay? I do the best that I can. And so this type of picture may look very naive, but if you take those oscillations back in one plane dimensions, this will take forever. Okay? And so the question is, how can we characterize it and understand why the condition number is important to characterize the oscillations? So first result, which is like this guy's from very long ago, is that if you assume strong convexity now, okay, so you're assuming already you're in a favorable position, then what you can show is so-called like linear convergence or exponential convergence. Is that the distance to optimum, okay, measure the function values, will be like a geometric sequence. So as t gets bigger, every time you increase t by 1, you multiply the error by a constant. And that constant is 1 minus mu over L. So if mu over L is very close to 1, that constant is very close to 0. So you drive down the error a lot as you get higher iteration. Okay, and again, I'm mentioning this is true for a constant step size, but if you do any form of live search which is reasonable, or do the exact live search, then this is something which you. Okay, so this tells you that in such, and this was a case where mu over L was 1, one iteration, boom, I get the optimum. Otherwise, I do a few oscillations. As you can see, when mu is 0, if you're just convex, the bound is still true. It simply tells you that you're not going to converge, but it's not giving you anything. So what you can show if you're just convex is that this exponential convergence rate gets you to something which is 1 over t. So you replace exponential by 1 over t. So this is much slower in the sense that it still converges. So if you have those oscillations, okay, they oscillate a lot, but you still make progress toward the optimum. Progress will be much slower and will be as 1 over t. And the proof is also quite simple, but it requires some knowledge about complex functions you don't want to go into. So we'll do the proof only for quadratics. And I believe this is a very sufficient for this thing. And one key element is that the algorithm remains the same. Whether you have a hard or a simple problem, you do that in this sense and it will adapt. If you are, it's going to be slow. But if it's easy, boom, you get this automatically with the exact same algorithm, and it is called adaptivity of data descent to the difficulty of the problem. So this may look like not important, this is crucial. Why? Because when you get closer to the optimum, the problem might get a bit easier. So if you're adaptive, the algorithm will try to get the most out of the problem. Okay, whereas if you're not adaptive, you have to help the algorithm to tell it, oh, now it's easier, go faster. Data descent is meant to be a bit of kind of magical algorithm, is that it automatically adapts. It's not the best, okay, yet. So there's some acceleration possible, which I will present briefly later. But this is like very simple. So Cauchy from the 19th century, and still like very efficient. The proof, it's easy if you know the classical tricks, classical tools, but let's make it even easier. Okay, I will do two proofs today, one for quadratics and one for data descent later on, for projective data descent. And this is will be a simple proof based on linear algebra. So I have a quadratic convex function. This is my quadratic term, this is my linear term. Now because the Hessian is constant for a quadratic function, I get U and L are simply the lowest, the smallest and largest eigenvalues of H. The common optimum is obtained by computing the gradient. So the gradient prime of theta is h theta in C. So if you set this to 0, you get the definition of theta star, which is a stationary point equation. So because I apply this, this is great for that, this is a simple linear system which can invert. Okay, this is theta star. Now let's look at gradient descent with a constant step size, okay, 1 over L. Then what I have, this is my iteration. I go from step t minus 1 to t by going down the negative gradient. This is my gradient at t minus 1 on that equation, a step size of 1 over L. Okay, so this is just writing down the gradient. Then I realize that C is equal to h of theta star by my stationary. By stationarity, so I get C replaced by h of theta star. And now what I see is that if I subtract everything theta star, okay, I just subtract theta star, I get the deviation to optimum is equal to the deviation to optimum minus something which also looks like a deviation to optimum. And if I just extract h by linearity, what I obtain is that my distance to optimum is a matrix times my distance to optimum at time t minus 1. Okay, this is just a linear system. Okay, this is very classical. If I do gradient descent on a quadratic function, I get a linear recursion. Okay, so distance to optimum is a matrix times the previous distance to deviation to optimum. And if I apply this t times, I get the power t of that matrix applied to the initial deviation from optimum. Okay, so now this is what makes quadratic functions easy to analyze. Now I have to analyze this matrix. It's a power of a matrix, and so I have to analyze the eigenvalues of that matrix, okay, to see how things are shrinking in every direction. And so this is what I'm going to do. So if I'm assuming a strong convexity, okay, then the eigenvalues of h are between u and l, okay, so I of h is between l and u. So the eigenvalue of 1 minus h over l will be between 0 and 1 minus mu over l. This is just like using the property of eigenvalues when you multiply the matrix by the number. If I take the power of t, so the eigenvalues of the power of a matrix and the power of the eigenvalues, so all of the eigenvalues are between of that matrix between 0 and 1 minus mu over n power t. Okay, so then you can apply a standard inequality that if all the eigenvalues of this are less than something, then the square norm of that will be less than the larger square eigenvalues times the initial norm over there. So I just get that the iterates do converge directly as a power of this, the square of this largest eigenvalue. And I get immediately the fact that I get this linear convergence. So one way to see it is to imagine that if you project this in the eigenbasis, okay, so if you assume h diagonal essentially, then what you have here is independent cost functions. Okay, so if h diagonal, if h is diagonal of some vector h, g of theta is equal to the sum over I from 1 to d of 1 over 2 h I times theta I square minus c I theta I. Okay? So the beauty of taking eigenvalues is that you can reparameterize the function if you want, where the function decouples. So it's a sum of functions that depend only on theta I. This means that all along all eigenvectors, things are independent. Okay, and along those eigenvectors, so we have a large value of h. So this will be like very picky. So this is a large h I. And so will be very slow, this will be a small h bar. Okay. Essentially, when you taking the max over all eigenvalues, essentially what dictates the convergence rate is the smallest HR. So when you have the least curvature, this will take you more time to make progress. Okay. So it's really the why I like this quadratic function is that you do have like all of those like optimization of the whole eigenvectors spaces are being done independently, and some are fast and some are slow, and the convergence rates depend on the slow response which corresponds to the smallest edge. Okay, so this is like in one line the value and the y you get 1 minus v of l to a given power t. You get the same proportional value, which I will not do. Now what happens when u is 0? When u is 0, okay, you get, this is still true, you get just like this is equal to 1, so you don't get, just avoid divergence, but this does not say anything. So now, let's take like convexity towards just u is 0. If I get the exact same behavior, okay, so the eigenvalues of I minus h over l are now between 0 and 1, okay, so there is no contraction. At the end, it will not work. Okay, so there is no convergence of the iterates. Okay, so this is something which is there is no proof of convergence of the iterates. And now if I take functional values, this is where things get a bit nicer, is for a quadratic function, g of theta minus g of theta star, if I do a theta expansion, the first term is zero because this is zero, the second term is zero because the grad of theta star is zero, and I just get the second order term, something like this. So essentially, the distance to optimum in function values, the only difference with the distance to optimum in iterates is the presence of h over them. And this would be a core difference. Why? Because along the eigenvalues where h is small, when h, the small h on the left is small, okay, I will converge slowly, but they don't count much because I don't divide by h I. Okay, so when I'm slow, doesn't count very much, and when I'm fast, it does count quite a bit. So now if I write down this for theta t minus g of theta star, I can simply take that thing, okay, so I get one half of theta t minus theta star, I get one edge from them, and I get one minus h over l times 2t times theta t minus theta star. Okay, so this comes from having that inequality, and there is 2t because I get 1 coming from there and 1 coming from I get 1 coming from there and 1 coming from there. And now I have to study the eigenvalues of that thing. Of that matrix, which is over there, and this one, okay, is the eigenvalues of that matrix are simply that are just like if I take V an eigenvalue of H, then the eigenvalues of the matrix on the left is simply V times 1 minus V over L times the power 2G of eigenvalues of H. So the largest eigenvalue will be the maximum of that thing. So the only thing that is different from before is the presence of V. Okay, this will make things very different. Why? Because when V is 0, okay, then it doesn't count. Then I can use a simple inequality, which is that V times 1 minus V over L to T. So this is less than V times exponential of minus 2T minus V over L times T. So just using that 1 minus U is less than exponential of U of minus U. Right. So this is something which is just true by a convexity. Okay. If I take this less than exponential of minus this, okay, then when I take a power to T, this enters exponential. And then I can use the fact that U exponential minus u is less than a constant. Okay? And that constant is, if I look at this, 1 over e. So u times plus or minus u, we see something, this is u, this is something like this, okay, so this is 1, this is 1 over e. So at the end, this means that this is less than, this is less than, so to apply u, f function minus u, I have to complete what is missing from here. What is missing is 2L, 2T over L. So I get a constant times 2L over T, which is essentially what is written over there, that the subproblem of that thing is less than a constant times 1 over T. So this is really like basic algebra to show that when this is, when V is big, then this become, this will be very small, like before, but when V is small, then this will, and when V tends to zero, this will have the behavior of 1 over T. This is where the 1 over T comes from. As we get V closer to zero, the decay is slower and slower, but it counts less and less, and if you combine the two together, you get 1 over T. Yes, so this is a simple way to get 1 over T. Without any like hard computations in play. Computation is one. So I encourage you to redo this like by yourself to convince yourself that at the end, even if you're not contracting a lot, V gets close to zero, you still converge. This is actually what you see over there. Okay, so you see here, you still make progress in that direction, although you oscillate a lot in the other direction. Any questions on that proof? So the proof in the general case is very similar. No, it's very different. Sorry. Very different. It just relies on properties of convex functions, and it's a bit magical. Okay? That you combine things and then boom, things come out. Whereas here, for quantity functions, you have this nice decomposition. So because you can always rotate your problem to make the Hessian diagonal, and then things will be optimized independently over all Eigenvector spaces. This is true for quadratics, this is not true all the time. Okay, if you have a logistic function, this will not be true that you can decompose your problem into independent function which only depends on a single problem. This was simply the simplest proof. This was the way to get like the four-line proof easy to know if you apply to quadratics. As I mentioned, this is not optimal after d iterations, okay? And then the way to make it optimal, and the way to make it optimal is to do so-called acceleration. So this dates back from Nesterov, okay? So this is like a very important result by Nesterov in the 80s. And so essentially the way, I don't want to spend too much time on the details of that. The just take home method is like very similar to momentum, for those who know what it means, is that you do the lesson step, but you keep a bit of the momentum from the first iterations, and by just adding like one more line of a linear computation, then you can improve this 1 over t to 1 over t squared. Okay, so this is quite significant when t, if you do 1,000 iterations, this may be like 1,000 times faster. Okay, so the proof is more complex. So we have one example in our paper, but really this dates back from Nesterov. There's a lot of variations, a lot of ways to give some intuition why, none of them being super really intuitive. But if you type for like explanation why Nesterov acceleration works on Google, we see tons of papers. None of them is very convincing. I've had one as well, just like putting myself in the lack of intuition. So it does work, and this is a thing that you should try on your own. It really does make a difference. And both in theory, okay, you go from 1 over to 1 over square, and in practice. Okay, so, and if you like, the neural network work, this corresponds to momentum, which is also used quite a bit. Then you become very provable, okay, in the sense that if you want to minimize the convex function g, which is smooth, then there is no way you can beat this. Okay. So this is really something that we do a lot in optimization. You have the people, you have two types of people providing algorithms. So give me a function g, I will certify that the performance after t iteration is this. And you have people from the opposite camp saying that you cannot beat that performance. Okay, by exhibiting a function g which is super difficult. And it turns out that for that class of problem, those two people agree. Those two people being the same person, Nesterov. Nesterov has this is consistent with himself. Okay, so he showed that the best you can do is this. You cannot beat this, and you can achieve it by using this simple trick. So you get the optimal rate for complex functions. Okay, so this is something which is important in practice. It does very well better. And for the complex case, it's a very simple. Then this extends to a strongly convex. Okay, so in a very similar way. You lose adaptivity. Okay, and what you get like you replace condition number. So from there, strongly convex. Very similar thing. You just have different term over there, and you replace condition number by the square root of the condition number. So for those who know about conjugate gradient, this should ring a bell. If you use conjugate gradient for quadratic functions, then you get the square root of the condition number being the quantity that drives convergence. And this also holds for, in fact, all strongly convex functions. It's also non-improvable. And now it's not anymore adaptive. It just said that it does depend on you. So the algorithm does depend on you now, but it's not adaptive anymore to strong convexity. So this is an acceleration. And then you get a thing which are okay. Alright, so now let's move on a bit for a bit more complex problem, because now I've assumed that G is complex and smooth. So this applies to logistic, okay, for example, about squares. But let's say that I have like L1 norm. Okay, so L1 norm is used quite a bit, and I've already mentioned it, it's used to do feature selection, but it's not differentiable. Okay, so if I apply LMD set with L1 norm, this should not work very fast. And for that, we're going to use proximal techniques. Again, I did not invent proximal techniques, but it's just a reference of a monograph like with many references in it. So one first thing to realize how you can apply gradient descent to like non-differentiable terms is to first rephrase gradient descent, okay, as a proximal technique. So one way of rephrasing gradient descent is I'm going to, at the given time step t, I'm going to make a Taylor expansion around theta t. This is a Taylor expansion, constant term, linear term, but because that Taylor expansion is true only locally, I'm adding a proximal term, which is called a proximal term, to make sure that theta remains close to theta t. And if I'm minimizing this, so essentially what I'm doing here, F over there, I have theta t over there, and I'm approximating essentially this F, this by a quadratic function, okay? Like this, I'm going to minimize this quadratic function, which is over there, and it's simple because a quadratic function, this is constant, this is a linear term, and this is simply the square norm. Okay? So there's no relation. So if I take the gradient of that and set it to zero, then I will get that essentially the next step is simply the gradient descent recursion. Okay, so here I'm being super pedantic, I'm rephrasing the good old-fashioned gradient descent as a proximal algorithm, which is kind of useless. Okay, so that is not super useful as is. And now, let's say I add some weird term. Let's take L1 norm. Okay? If I add the L1 norm, then I can reproduce the exact same argument. Okay? I can do a Taylor expansion of F. F is still differentiable. F is not. Okay, logistic, for example. But it's still like differentiable. Same Taylor expansion. Same proximal term to remain close to my current iterate. And I keep my my regularizer intact. Okay, and now I minimize this. Okay. Now two questions. Is it really simple to minimize? The answer would be yes for simple cases. And do I still get like fast convergence? So let's answer the second question first. So there's many nice papers showing that indeed if you have this potentially non-smooth term, then you preserve the rest of convergence. So all this 1/T, 1/T², and all this exponential convergence are preserved. You still minimizing a non-smooth function, because one term may be non-smooth, but you still super fast. Okay, so you still preserve the benefits of smoothness of f. Okay, this is nice. And is it easy to solve? And again, that function is what? This is like constant, don't really care about it. Linear function, easy. This one is a quadratic function but with no relation. So it does decouple exactly like in this way. So if you take, for example, the L1 norm, okay, the L1 norm is the sum of the singular of the absolute value to the components of theta. This L1 norm also decouples as a sum of terms. Okay, and each of them is depending on the single component of theta. So in the context of L1 norm, this is easy to show. Why? So this is easy to perform because it does decouple in every direction as a problem of that kind. I have to minimize the quadratic function plus the absolute value, okay, which is a 1D problem. And this is easy, and I will not look at the details, but this is trying to minimize a form which is convex, okay, which potentially has a kink at zero, is quadratic on the right, quadratic on the left, and by just computing left and right derivative, you can decide whether the optimum is at zero or not. And I will not go into the details, it's very classical, so please go through it by yourself. And what you can get is that at the end, the solution is this one, is that if you don't have lambda over there, the optimum is x equals 1. And if you add lambda times the absolute value, you get the so-called sub-specialing operator, where you just preserve the sign of y, but shrink the absolute value to 0, okay, by subtracting lambda. And if that shrinking will make this like too close to 0, you make it equal to 0. Okay, so essentially, this is soft-specialing operator. If you do compress sensing, would there be a compress sensing talk this super school? No. Oh, this was fashionable 5 years ago. Yes, so this is like very classical. So just as a summary, whenever you have like a simple term like L1 norm, then this will be take a gradient and then take like a soft-specialing. So in terms of computations, that step has zero cost. Okay, so you can benefit whenever you use an L1 norm, then you can benefit from the fast convergence due to the smooth term by doing these proximal techniques. Of course, if you change your regard to something which is more complicated, then this may be harder to compute. And in that book, we have a lot of examples of like elements omega for which this can be computed efficiently. So there are many, many of them. And any like regularizer that you can think of, if it is like smart intelligence, if it is like well chosen, this is going to be true. This operation is going to be easy. Okay. Alright, so this is like for L1 norm. And one other example is if you have a constraint. Okay, you can say you want to optimize over a constraint set. We have seen before optimizing over a ball. Okay. Then if you apply this possible technique, okay, where now this the function omega here, take omega of theta as being equal to zero if theta is in k and plus infinity otherwise. Okay, then minimizing f plus mu omega is really minimizing f over k. So now if we apply the so-called proximal technique, the proximal state becomes minimizing over k your like general expansion plus proximal term, and you can like rewrite it, you can factorize it to get that essentially you recover projective gradient descent. Okay, so if you want to optimize this is the constraint set, okay? And if you want to optimize the function, you make a random step, and if you make a random step that goes out, you you project back again to your constant set. This is the double spin you can think of, and this essentially converges as fast as a non-projective element set. Okay, this is quite. Any questions on that? This is like standard thing, but the beauty of those like analyses is to show that you don't lose anything by doing projections or by doing like stuff. So this was for the smooth case. Okay. Now, beyond gradient, you can use Newton. Okay. So what is Newton? In fact, it's a bit similar to the proximal technique, but you do a second order integral expansion. So that a given iteration, I do a second order to the expansion, constant term, okay, linear term, quadratic term, and now I'm minimizing this and with respect to theta. This is quadratic, hence I can form the gradient, invert linear system, this is my formula, okay, I will not go over the details, you have to solve the linear system. So on the negative side, you have to solve linear system, so in general this is all pq, unless you make some extra assumptions, which I don't want to make at the moment. This is on the negative side. On the positive side, you get so-called quadratic convergence. So this means that once you're close enough, it's a local quadratic convergence. Once you're close enough, as soon as you go from step t minus 1 to t, you square the error. Okay, so if this was 10 to the minus 3, this becomes 10 to the minus 6. Next steps become 10 to the minus 12, and next steps 10 to the minus 24. This means that this goes really super fast. When you enter this regime of quadratic convergence, this will be very fast, okay? But every two caveats, it takes you some time to get this well enough, okay? And every iterate is slow to obtain because you have to solve the linear system. But if you want to get to machine precision, it's a good way to get. So to summarize a bit what we've seen for smooth functions, this is an important summary slide. When I want to minimize the smooth function, you can do the registered, which I'm sure all of you knew about, and the time it takes to convert will depend on the nicety of the function. So if you're easy, you get exponential convergence, otherwise only 1 over t. This is not optimal, it can be accelerated using Westermann acceleration. So, 1 over t becomes 1 over t square, and this you get the square root, so it gets faster. If you go to Newton, you get quadratic convergence, so you get the power of 2 in the exponential, very fast. So, this is a summary for the smooth case. So, what I'll do now is for the last, next 20 minutes, to go over the non smooth case. Okay? So it's a bit counterintuitive in that the non-smooth case is easier to analyze than the smooth case. Okay? So this is one way to do it. Okay, from smooth to non-smooth, let's look at a similar descent, or gradient descent. So first, one slide of big warning, when you do non-smooth optimization, things that could work before may not converge anymore. Okay, so let's take steepest descent, which is like a descent is like line search, going to exact line search. This will always be convergent if you are smooth, but may not converge if you're not smooth. Take this function, this is like a level set, this is like the optimum is over there. Okay, and if you start, it's not smooth because there is like a this is non differentiable, it's not twice differentiable along like those lines. If you start there, if you do steepest descent, you will always converge slowly to that point. Okay? But at that point, okay, it's not optimal because you're lower here. So this is a very classical example that things that were working in the smooth case are not working there. Okay, this is like very important. When you're not smooth, you can get stuck if you're not careful. This is the context, okay? So it's not a matter of convexity versus non-convexity. It's a case where the context problem for which, if you're too naive, this is going to happen. And I know a certain proportion of you saying that, yeah, it's just like a good example, this never happens in practice. How many of you thought that? Okay, sir. Okay, good. Yeah, this happens in practice. Okay, so you will get stuck. Not if you use the SVM, because with the SVM you have a lot of non-differentiability points, but because you have average of how many points, it goes away. But if you do L11, since you want to converge at a point where you're not differentiable, both to get zeros, then you get the problems. And our own personal story on that. Next deadline, non smooth problem, convergence for one data set, not convergence for the other data set. We didn't know why. This was non smoothness. Okay? We didn't submit. Important. Okay. Got a paper award at the next conference. Okay. So do not submit when things are not converging. Okay, this is this happens in practice. Alright, after this nice word of caution, let's look at algorithms. Okay, so since we know that simple algorithms may fail, we have to change something. Okay, so it's good to consider. So projective data descent. So we want to minimize a complex function on a board like that. And we're going to consider the classical algorithm for that, which I've shown recently, which is just before, which is projective data descent. But now I'm going to use not a constant step size, but a decaying step size. Okay? As one of our routines, which does not start to decay. And the goal is to show that these three converge. Okay, this is projective data descent. This is a set of constraints. Okay, I move along the gradient. If I go too far, I project back into what you can show, and this dates back from Shaw from 1985, that the value at the average iterate goes down to zero as 1 over root t. Okay, so this is much slower than before. It's not 1 over t or 1 over t squared, it's 1 over root t. Okay, and remember, when t is 10,000, okay, root t it starts to be 100, so it may be like a lot slower. Nice, the best you can do for that kind of problem. And the proof is three lines, and I will do the proof. Okay? And the proof is the dead stack from Shore. It's reused many places in online learning. So seeing it works, I think, is interesting. It looks a bit magical, but at the end, it's really three lines. But the key here is that you do get convergence. But at the right one over t, and all constants are explicit. Alright, but let's go for it. It will be the last proof. Okay, okay, so this is the derivation, projective gradient descent. I have a step size, I have assumptions, my gradients are bounded, and my iterates remain bounded because I project. So let's go for it. So when you want to analyze convergence typically or algorithms, what you hope is that things get better as you go along. This is the hope. So typically, we have seen two quantities which were good to characterize conversion. We have seen distance to optimum. And we have seen as well the distance to optimum in function value. So here's Dasta, the minimizer of the whole. And what we hope is that when you go from step t minus 1 to t, one of those two gets smaller. Okay? So this is a typical proof technique. We hope that this gets smaller. So we're going to take one of them. Okay? Let's take distance to optimum. Okay? And the hope is that this gets smaller as I iterate over my problem. So let's look at the line. So theta t is a projection. Okay, theta star is in my set, and what I do is that when I do orthogonal projections, okay, these will always make points closer to each other. It's called contractivity of projection. After projection, points are closer to each other. Okay, so this means that after projection, I'm closer than before projection. Okay, this is just using contractivity of projection. Theta t is a projection of this. And theta star is the projection itself, so I get those two pieces coming from there. So this is just compatibility of projections. Then I can expand the square. This is where the square norm is important. Okay, so I have the square norm, so I have the dot products. I can expand the square. This is like first square, second square, the cross product over there. This is inequality. Then I can use the fact that my radius are bounded, okay, to replace this by this square. Okay, so this is simply the boundary radius. Now I get this ordering term, but I've been saying this on the right for the last 2 hours, which is simply that that quantity is simply the gradient dot product with deviation to optimum. So, and this is what we call like a surrogate to distance to optimum. Okay, so if this is small, this is small. Okay, so this controls that guy. So if I get minus that guy, this is less than minus that guy. And this is what I have here. Minus this is less than minus distance to optimum. And now I'm almost down. Okay, so I get this kind of descent. Distance to optimum, okay, is less the distance to optimum before I start, okay, so I want to get progress, but I get some positive term, so this may increase if I get a big step, but I get a negative term. Why is this negative? Because if I start the optimal value, so this is always positive, so this will make a contract, okay, and as when I'm very far from the optimum, this will be very big, and when I get close, it will be very small, okay, so this is the journey where things stop. Okay, so this is where now you can use algebra to get convergence. So how does it work? So this is a hypothetical we use like so-called Lyapunov techniques. You isolate that term on the left, okay, so you make it only on the left. So you get this plus that minus this. You divide by 2 gamma t. This is what you obtain over there by just isolating that term over there. And now what you see appearing is a nice telescoping sum. Okay, a telescoping sum. So if you sum this, if you assume gamma t is constant, if you sum this, you will get a telescoping sum. So let's do that. But before doing this, let's remember where everything comes from. The idea is to simply consider a simple like, quantity that is supposed to go down to zero as I get closer to convergence. And I realize that it does go down, but I get some nice contracting term and some nasty term. And if I isolate this nice contracting term, I get a simple inequality over there where things may go and telescope. So now let's start from that. Okay? Oh, we start from that. And now for simplicity, you can assume a constant step size. Okay, it's going to be simpler. And you get a constant step size and take all of that and apply them for t. T minus 1, T minus 2 of up to 0. Okay, so if you sum all of those from u equals 1 to t, then you sum all of those from u equals 1 to t with the gamma at a constant, okay? You sum all of those from u equals 1 to t with the gamma is constant. And here what you see that now you get a factor t over there because you sum a constant. And here you see a telescopic sum because the 2 be telescope and you just keep the first term, which is theta 0 minus theta star. Okay. And now, due to the fact that these are all like the ball of part of radius d, you get d square. Okay. And what you obtain is that the sum of that, okay, is less than this, with a term that you get on gamma here and inverse gamma over there. But you can optimize over gamma. Okay. So you have two real numbers whose product is constant. The sum is minimum and all 2 are equal, the 2 are equal. So if you minimize this with respect to gamma, you get that gamma over there, and you get this decaying step size. Okay. And if you report the value of gamma over there, so do the computation alone later, you get a root t over there. Okay. And now we are almost down. Now we want to get the value at the average here. We use Jensen's inequality, okay? This is G is convex, so this is the second time we use convexity. But the average of all of that is a bound on our distance to optimum. And you get this over T, and you get one over T. Okay, so this is like the condensed version of the proof. So please go look at it again before the class tomorrow, just to realize this is just a sequence of simple arguments. Okay? So here, Please compare this to the party function proof, which was very clear and direct. This one is manipulation of inequalities. We end up with a solution, but the intuition is a bit lost. But I'm showing this because it's to give you a flavor of how things are proven in that area. This is just simple-based algebra taken with the correct form. So here, a big caveat is that I use the constant step size. Okay? And the step size here, the optimal one depends on the horizon. So for that type of proof, you need to know when you want to stop. So I'm going to commit to t directions. If I want to do t directions, I should do that step size. This is never what you want to do in practice. But typically, you don't decide when you stop in advance. You write the algorithm and you stop when you're fed up. Okay? It's typical. This is what I do. Okay? Or you stop when the test error is slow enough. But typically, you never want to have a guarantee that you deeper the horizon. And this, you can do the same proof with a decreasing step size, which is a bit more complex. So I will not do it. This is simply applying Abel smashing formula. What we need is a bit too complex, but it's really like classical algebra. And at the end, what you obtain, the key is that at the end, the same result holds, which is that after t iterations, if you use a decaying step size, the distance to optimum is simply 1 over root. So this is the proof. Let me go through it one more time. Okay, so you have some algebra part, which is on that slide, and you have some convex analysis part, which is on the previous slide. Okay, so let's go over the convex analysis part again. The goal is to take the iteration, find something that goes down and you see more data, okay, more iterations, and this is distance to optimum. Using probability projections. Extension of the norm, property of like surveillance which I had seen earlier, then you get to this like simple inequality, and then you use algebra to get to it. So I don't expect you to remember this, okay? I expect you to know where to look for it when you see it. Okay? And also I expect you to understand how people proving like common algorithms. We have seen quadratics. Get the formula, and study it, it's what we did. Or you find what is called a Lerner function, something that is supposed to go down along iterations. So two types of proof techniques. And then this is really like a simple argument. And that argument is used over and over again in the machine. Alright, so yep. So here, so this is after you do the algebra, you get that inequality, and now you have something which is growing in gamma, decaying in gamma. Okay, so you have a trigger in gamma, okay, and you have two solutions. Take the knowledge in gamma and set it to zero, okay, or use knowledge, those two things that have a constant product, and their sum is minimized when they're equal. And this is like fancy way of saying it, but if you prefer, take the gradient, set it to zero, you should get this. Alright, so now let's combine everything together. Okay, with my slide from before. Remember this. Now let's go back to machine learning. We need to minimize f hat. This is f hat. We're minimizing a function, which is convex, on a convex set, which is the one which I have used before. What I have from statistics, what I have is that in high probability, L and F hat are close, okay, and when I minimize F hat, I'm going to pay a price of 1 over root L. On top of that, because I need to optimize F hat, I will not be able to get the global optimum with a much precision. I'm going to get some precision, and that precision is only 1 over root T, when T is the number of iterations of better descent. This is what I just showed. Is that f hat at my iterations after t iteration of the descent compared to the best, to the minimizer of f hat. You see what I'm minimizing when I do a better descent. This will deviate from 1 over root t. So now I get this nice combination of what we call the optimization error, 1 over root t, and statistical error, 1 over root n. So if I don't want to lose when I optimize, I should do at least the order of n iterations of n descent. Now let's look at complexity. If I do n iterations of n descent, what is the complexity? I have to compute n times the gradient of that function. But that function is the average of all of my local loss functions. So every time I have to compute the gradient of f hat, I have to look at the entire data set. So this is all nd. For each function, computing the gradient, I need to compute the dot product over v, okay? And I have to do it n times over nd. Every iteration costs me over nd. If I put n iterations, I get over n squared. Okay, so this is like a theoretical way of saying that data descent does not have a good governor size. Right? Because when n is 1 billion, it's not going to be very nice because n squared is very big. Okay, so at the end, really, the beauty of that is that the two analyses, the statistical one, which I have shown before the break, and the optimization one, they match really, because they have the exact same behavior. When you replace m number of observations by t number of iterations. Okay. And if you combine those two together, having t equal to m, you get the bad complexity. Okay. So you can answer this in fact, if you do gradient descent, you will take forever because every step is possible. So this is really the if you do the two separately and then merge them, you get to pay a price of all the stuff. Very important caveat, those are all the upper bounds. Okay? Whenever you see the upper bound, and people like me trying to draw conclusion from the upper bounds, you have to be very skeptical and careful. Okay? So those are super loose upper bounds. They are true, of course. But the practical behavior may be much better. Okay. So for very weird functions, it's going to be tight. Okay. But in practice, maybe a bit better. So be very careful. Whenever you see an upper bound, things that are typically a bit pessimistic. And if you follow this pessimistic view, then the best you can do is L squared D, if you separate it. Any questions on that slide? It's an important one. So what I'm going to do now for the last half hour is to drive n squared d to all the nd with zero line of computation, zero line of analysis. Zero, 0.5. All right. So now let's go. And before that, if you're strongly convex, you can show you get one of your ut instead of one of your ut, I don't want to spend the question. That. Okay, so now let me summarize what I've seen for convex functions. Okay, I've seen that. So this is a summary of what we have seen before. So I'm going to show this like several times today and tomorrow. Convex, only convex. Okay, non-smooth, hard, smooth, easier, quadratic, supposed to be super easy. Okay, and what I've seen just now is that if you are convex, you take 1 over root t, okay, so this is really slow. Okay. And if you're smooth, you have seen that less time acceleration, you get 1 over t squared, much faster. And quadratic, there's not much you can do better here, yeah? Instead of 1 over t squared. If you're strongly complex, I've just showed briefly 1 over root t, 1 over t. Here, you get linear convergence, okay, and quadratic, you get the same thing. So this is the summary of like, convex optimization, depending whether you're smooth, not smooth, convex, strongly convex. Okay, so this is for SVM type, logistic, or least squares. So you can see that you can get much faster when you get smoothness. This is for optimization. Now, let's look at a few things. So first, let's have a few like nice insights from you're going to the David Bousquet and others before. In learning, since we are minimizing an average, it's useless to get this precision to be machine precision. Okay, so if you want those to be machine precision will take you forever for those. This will not take you forever, but the problem is that every iteration will be very, very slow. Okay, so in machine learning, this is usually like low precision. In machine learning, cost functions are averages. In all over that, none of those like algorithms were using the fact that I have an average as g an average. Okay? And finally, very important, we don't care so much about f hat. Okay? Doing well on our training data is irrelevant. What we care about is doing well on our testing data. Okay? This is really like very important insights which make machine learning different from optimization. We are using optimization, but we are different. Okay, we are different in those three ways, which really are important. If you do signal processing, this is not true. Okay, signal processing, your functions are not. You may get a set of functions, but they are really not ID. Okay, so if you take an average of non-independent functions, they will not converge. They will not like this one of them is not true anymore if you don't have independence. And yes. Keep in mind, this is really specific to machine learning. Alright, so now let's look at what we can do. What we can do is called stochastic approximation or stochastic analysis. So now the goal is to minimize the function f, but f is going to be the test error. Okay, so we will not invert f anymore for the training error. Okay, training error for babies. Okay, we want to check other data if we do well or not. Okay, from now on, for the next half hour, we never ever complete the training error. Okay? It's never clear anymore. Okay? For today. Okay? We're going to directly try to minimize the test error. You must think, okay, it's stupid, we don't have access to test error, that's true. We don't have access to test error, but we may have access to something which is a noisy estimate of test error. Okay? We to assume that we don't get access to the gradient of the test error, but to a noisy gradient which has the current expectation. See what I mean by unbiased. I'm going to assume that I have access to the noisy gradient whose expectation is correct. Okay? So I have so SS, my usual things. This is my usual like contour plots. So I'm there. It's a gradient, okay? I'm going to assume that I have something which is around it, okay? And like, I can want one sample of that where I get the correct expectation from another edge, I'm correct, but I may be, all of the points may be quite far away, okay? So if I don't know a single signal HED, then the noise of the gradient, it has zero expectation, but the variance does not need to go to zero. So you don't need the noise to get reduced and to get more iterations. Okay? You can always have noise, and this will still converge. Okay? So zero expectation, but the variance can be quite large. This does not matter, it always comes. Well, so for us, for machine learning, this is going to be obvious as what noisy estimate we need to consider. We need to consider the estimate related to a single observation. I take x and y n. Okay, and this is like a function. Okay, because I've assumed that my data are ID, the expectation of FN is my test error. Okay, and if you're willing to invert gradient and expectation, the gradient of the test error is the expectation of my stochastic gradient. If I take a single observation, okay, for the loss, compute the gradient of the loss, this has the correct expectation. This will deviate, okay, of course, because we have some noise, but it has zero expectation. And what we may need like access to independent gradients. This means that for all the theory we're going to do now, and I'll come back to that tomorrow from the more practical side, that since I need independent access to gradients, I'm not allowed to reuse an observation twice. This could be said as a bug in the feature. So if you see it as a feature, then if I'm not allowed to see an observation twice, that's good because I can stop early. I do a single pass, I stop, I'm done because I tell you that it's forbidden to do two passes. So this is like the correct, this is like the positive way, the positive spin on it. The number of iterations should be equal to the number of observations if you want the theory that we represent to be true. But in practice, as I will show tomorrow, always makes more sense to do several passes. Okay, there's a bit of a mismatch between the theory and practice. But from now on, I'm going to assume the number of iterations is exactly the number of observations. This means that now I'm going, let's skip that. Let me skip that as well. No, let me do this. Okay, so here, what I'm doing now is I'm trying to minimize cluster off, okay, and I'm going to use the gradient of a single observation. This is what I call stochastic approximation. What we have done before is what we call batch learning. Okay, we have a finite set of observations, Z, so Z1 is X1 by 1, etc. We form the empirical risk F hat. We de-minimize F hat over a set of class, and then we use some deviation inequality between F and F hat to make sure that, we didn't overfit. This is what we did before, and this is what we're doing now. There's another like guy on the blog, which is called online learning, and I don't want to go too much about it, but this is a case where observations arrive one by one and are potentially adversary. The adversary may look at your past behavior to give you really bad data. So there is a very nice work on that, so I don't want to make to talk too much about it. The important aspect is the difference between batch learning, where I see the data at once and I'm allowed to make whatever I want, but to avoid overfitting, I have to regularize. Whereas in that setup, I'm going to see every observation once, and only once, and I don't need to regularize to avoid overfitting because I'm going to do a single pass. Alright, so let's look at the model. It's LGD, so we just go down the negative gradient. Okay, not on F, because we don't know F, but just this negative gradient. And we're going to do averaging, okay, which is like averaging on the side, so we're going to call Polyak Clifford averaging. When I say averaging on the side, I don't put the average back into the equation. So I look at this viscosity gradient, and on the side I update the average. Of course, to compute the average, I don't need to store all of the iterates. I can update the average as I go down. And now the killer question is, what should the step size be? Okay, so the deterministic setup, the step size was easy. Understand you just put constant or like certain is not easy. But now is really a key problem. How should I choose my step size? And depending on the set theory, yes, you will use a different setup. So if you look at Robin Spondoro's paper and papers up to the 80s, they will tell you the best step size is 1/8. C over 8. Okay? It's no doubt the best one. Okay, if you paper, even by Leon or two. That's fine, Leon. You say, really, use C over N and find C whatever, the way you like. Okay? And then, so this, as I will show tomorrow, this is not fast. The same that this will be far too small. Okay? And now, people are looking more at step size of that form, C over N. Okay, so much faster, bigger step sizes. So these are adapted to well-conditioned problems. So if you're strongly convex, this is fine. But if you just convex, if you're in high dimensions, this is not going to work. And now more and more, and we'll talk about that tomorrow as well, to take gamma and become constant. Okay? This is how people use a lot of machine learning in the neural networks now in Microsoft. Okay, so 60s, 70s, 90s, and that is what people are also right now. Okay, so this is still like, of course there is no universal answer. Okay, I'm just throwing out those like bias dependencies to be very explicit the fact that this could depend on the type of problems. So now let's look at the basic setup. So what is our wish list? Okay, so there is a wish list, and I'm sorry that the wish list will not be satisfied. Okay. Although I know that people have chores for Christmas, okay? I had chores yesterday, but I have not Santa Claus. I will not be able to give you all of that for stochastic gradient. So what you want this? What you want this to be applicable to learning, okay, to be easy. But you want to avoid that having to know all the constants in advance. Okay? You want to close the algorithm and let it go through. This will not be super true. You would like to be adaptive as well. So you launch the algorithm, and if you're easy or hard, you want it to adapt and to pass space as it can. This will not be true as well. Okay? So unfortunately, you're going to lose some of the nice benefits of random descent. But this is going to gain in terms of computational. Alright, so let's look. This will be the only little that we need to see essentially today. So let's look at the classical setup. Now, fn is convex, so it's just a loss for a single observation. It's going to be non-smooth, okay, ID, okay, so that has a correct expectation. Theta star is the global optimum of my test error. It's the best I can do if I'm restricting myself to compact set. And I'm going to consider projective random descent, projective stochastic random descent. Same thing as before, but I'm going to inflate my true gradient by the stochastic gradient. That's exactly the same from before. One subtle change, I've been placed T by M everywhere. Okay. It's not a typo, it's on design because it's just to highlight the fact that, that the number of iterations is equal to the number of observations. Okay. So as soon as I stop and I finish my data, so by design, okay, yeah. So what I'm going to show you that we get the exact same behavior as for the deterministic case. So the if I do averaging, the distance to optimal function value and the test error. So I'm going to predict on unseen data compared to my best predictor, the difference will go to zero, okay, at the right number of them. It's the best you can do, okay? And the running time is over ND. Okay? ND is why ND? Because every step is O of D. You have to count the single vector dimension this, O of D. You do any iterations, O of ND. Okay? And the bad thing is when I cover the exact same rate as before. When we were separating statistics of optimization, you obtain the rate of overall, okay? And you get the same here, but with O of ND instead of O of X squared. Okay? So let's look at the scalar proof, and I will probably end with this because it's the same proof. Okay. Let's look at the proof, the same proof. This is something that has to change, of course. So this is my stochastic gradient. Okay. So I have to introduce like the quantity fn here. Fn is the information up to time n. So as I go along, okay, I see a new data point. Okay. Step 1, I observe like x1 by 1. Okay, do a step of x2, y2, do a step x1. Okay, so whatever when I define theta n, so theta n depends on what? On all of the past. Okay, theta n has access to x1, x2, up to xn. So I want one up to yn. But theta n, to compute then, I've never needed to have access to theta n plus 2, x n plus 1, s n plus 2, and so on. Okay, so when I look at theta n, I only need to look at the information up to time n. And of course, theta n minus 1 only depends on the information up to time n minus 1. So I'm going to assume that my terms are bounded. Okay, bounded iterates. I have unbiased gradients. Okay, so gradient of fn given the past, okay, will be f because fn are ID here, anyway. I'm going to first look at the distance to optimum. Okay, so this is a random quantity. Okay, it's a random quantity because theta is random now. I can use probability of projection, exactly the same thing as what I had before. I can expand this like before, expand the square. It's called the square term of that. The square of that, but you leave the fact that I have this, okay? Then I'm expanding the cross. This is the cross product. This minus this, twice this times this. And the only difference with what I had before is the fact that I have n and not f prime. Okay, I have this stochastic gradient. And now what I can do is the beauty of the expectations. I will condition over the past. I'm going to use the past is fixed. I have observed x1 to xn minus 1. I'm only considering the randomness depending on xn, yn, so the randomness depending on fn. So if I look, given the past, this is constant because it depends on the past. This is constant. This is constant. And this is the only place where I depend, I don't depend only on the past. But I know that given the past, fn is f. If I take expectations given the past, I can replace fn by f. Okay? And now I can reuse the same thing as before, reusing my inequality over there. Okay? So this is a surrogate to expand. Now I can take full expectations, okay? Replace everything. So I get the full expectation by the tower angle of expectations. I get the full expectation, it's constant. I get the full expectation. So the difference from what I had before, it's just like three characters, expectations all over the place, okay, instead of no expectations. So all the algebra I was doing before can be done the same way. I can isolate the term alone, this tends to optimum. I get the exact same telescopic sum, okay, I can recover the exact same thing, and I get the expected value of the test error at the energy direct. Minus the best test error goes down to 0 at 1 over 1. Okay, so here, I see the exact same proof because the proof relies on a very simple argument. Okay, so what I was able to do with the deterministic algorithm, I can do with stochastic algorithm. And now, of course, I have to change something that before this is a random quantity. Okay, why? So f is a deterministic, the test error. But theta is random. It depends on my data, which is random. And now I take the expectation. Now I get the deterministic quantity. And this goes to zero as one over root. This is a simple proof. And I won't do any more proof this lecture, this is the last proof. This is how you obtain proof of it. Yeah, so as a summary, so this is really like an important slide. Simply states the fact that stochastic gradients, okay, you get the exact same bound, but now you have access to stochastic gradient or the test error. It's really the key aspect is that what I'm not doing, important because I will do it tomorrow. I'm not forming f hat, I could do that, okay? I could say, oh, this is true, okay? Or I could say, this is an expectation, okay? Over this recept, and I could say, oh, I'm going to do stochastic gradient by simply sampling the replacement for my data set. Okay? I could do something like this. I could sample with replacement. I could say, oh, I will take a function at random, okay, and take a stochastic gradient. So I can reuse functions, okay, several times. When I choose a function at random, I of t is a selection at random from my data set, then I may reuse the same function several times. So, but if I do this, I'm going to get a bound on f hat, okay, but not a bound on f. Very important is that whenever I do like several passes, okay, for example, by doing something with replacement from a data set, then I'm going to get a bound where this will be f hat. Okay, so the test error. If I do something without replacement, when I go over the data only once, then I get a bound on the test error. Okay, this is really a key element is that AGB does minimize the test error. So the big difference is you can do the same thing if you have 20-strong complexity. I don't want to go over it because this is really the same. And I want, if you don't like results in expectation, okay, if you want to get results in high probability, it's easy. Okay, you can get either simply using Markov inequality, or you can do better by using like more refined Gidish inequality. So this is like really. Very important probably for you, but it's important for analysis because what could happen is that the expectation is correct. Maybe I'm looking at some time, things get like out of hand, you get a bad result. Those results tell you that, in fact, no, the probability of deviating too much from a result goes down to zero is going to be fast. This is very stable. Okay, so this is really the take-home message. And now, you can do possible steps. Okay, so if you like L1 norm, essentially you can add, you can minimize like expectations of F plus omega, okay, against L1 norm. And as you should expect, I'm just going to do the possible step, because this works, it's very nice, like algorithms. Nice paper doing this. There are other ways of doing it. So you may have seen like dual averaging, just another way of stating this. You also have neural descent. So if you optimize the recent text, it's maybe interesting. So I encourage you to look at the book by Sébastien Bubeck to get a bit more of that. Okay, so I won't have time to deal with this like in 4 hours and a half. And what I want to finish with is that last slide is the optimality. Okay, who is a computer scientist here? Okay. So do you know of any lower bounds of complexity in computer science? No. Actually you have a lot. You have a lot of upper bounds, you have a lot of NP highest results, but saying that whatever SAT will take at least SAT time, it's very hard. I'm not understood. Optimization is much easier. Why? Because we can define a set of rules which are easy. Okay, so whenever you want to derive lower bounds, so the worst, the best you can achieve, the best you can achieve for a type of problem is to define the rules of the games. Okay, and when you do like computer science, the rules of the games are part of the not very clear, whereas here it's very clear. Let's say I want to minimize the function f, okay, and I'm giving you a rules which is I'm allowed to access noisy values of f, or noisy values of f at any given point. Okay, this is a classical rule, which is adapted to machine learning. Okay. So I'm allowed to query function f by adding gradients and function values with some noise. Okay. I'm going to define a class of function on which I want to minimize, multiple functions, okay, and a contact set. And I'm going to give you like a performance measure. Okay, so given algorithm, given function f, okay, what I want is that when I apply the algorithm, okay, the distance to optimum has to be small. Okay. Then if I give you the algorithm, the way you're going to characterize performance is what I did earlier on is I took its performance across all potential functions f in my class. Okay, what I've done before here. I don't know. There, and for any f, it is true that I get a nice one. Okay? This is what I've done before. Okay? And so for a given algorithm, I want the sin power of a function f, but of course, I want to get the best algorithm. So I want to take the infimum over all algorithms. Okay? So the inf of algorithms and the sin power of all functions. And this is called the minimax performance. It's the best you can do of a type of problem. And of course, you want to achieve an algorithm which is as close to it as possible. And what I've shown earlier, when you exhibit an algorithm, you get an upper bound on that. It's an infimum. So I give you an algorithm, LGD. This is going to give you an upper bound on that. And what you can show, this is nice result by Nicolas Finudin, but easily explained by Agarwal et al. Is that satisfactory, okay, is in fact also of the order of 1/10. Let's compare that at the moment. So how it is done? By exhibiting half functions. Okay, so the goal is to create functions for which no algorithm will be able to do any things. Okay, so this is like the business of lower bounds. It's a very nice paper. If you like lower bounds, then you can get some lower bounds. And those developments are much really rely on the randomness of the problem. This is where it's possible to get some lower bounds. And the magic is that the lower bounds do match the upper bounds. Okay? So this means that up to the constant factor, then you do get the exact same dependency 1/n or 1/n. Okay? So just to highlight the, so when we say that a G is optimal, it's a very precise type of rules. Okay? Those rules, if you allow to put a efficacy value, and if you give a given class of functions, a given Laplace measure, you get the optimality. If you like that type of thing, you can look at the vector value. Alright, so what are we doing? So this is the end of today. So, okay, then the final set of today. I added a line to my plot. If my goal determinism is stochastic. Okay, so now what this is deterministic means I'm minimizing training error. Now I'm minimizing test error with a single pass. And the beauty is that in the non-smooth case, I was able to replace T by M. Okay, which is simply saying that a single pass will be enough. And one negative of saying it is that this is so slow that it's not perturbed by randomness. Okay, when we go there, I wish we would be able to replace T by M, but this would not be the case. Okay, I'm saying that in a sense, randomness will hurt a lot those conversion spikes, so we're going to lose exponential, okay, and this is going to be the topic of the GDE tomorrow. So what do you do with your smooth, okay, and then what do you do if you're doing the final process, and hopefully this will be 1 hour now. Any questions on the last lecture? Yep.
In the
okay, so what comes of the variance? Good question. So this is okay, a very good question, because if you see this one, it's small, compact, so it's a positive spin, but you lose any intuition. Okay, you lose, but if I start close to the optimum, you will do better. Okay, if I get high variance of the gradients, you will do better or not. Okay, everything is stuck into that. So why is it the case here? We use two of the gradients are bounded. Okay? So we just bound the variance of the gradient by the total number of the gradients. So we lose a lot. So what we're going to do tomorrow, in fact, is like a spoiler alert. I'm going to get something like that. Okay? When we get the node of the gradient going to appear, and distance to the turn is going to appear. In the sense that if I start closer, I should do better. Okay? If I have zero nodes, I should do better. Okay, this is going to appear tomorrow. It's a bit more complex, but this is really the key of okay, so the problem with node analysis, okay, is that it's too compact to be of any use in practice. Okay. It's true, of course, I'm not saying like incorrect thing, but it's super loose because you lose a lot of the intuition. It's a very brutal bound, and the goal of planning theory is going to get things which are finer and finer to get closer to what we should tell you. This is what we're going to do tomorrow, trying to get like better algorithms. There will be some plots, okay, so here I've managed to spend 3 hours with any plots. There will be some plots, okay, conversion plots, and so on, okay. So we'll be a bit more plots tomorrow, and other questions? Yep. To accelerate, you need smoothness, okay?
Yeah.
So you improve a bit, okay, but not on the right. You will still be 1 over n. You will improve the constant in front of 1 over n. Okay, so this is going to be also a good term tomorrow. Acceleration, the stochastic case is still open.